Genesis and biblical discernment. The best place to get our definition for discernment actually comes from the Bible. And we can turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 21 and 22, where it states this. As Christians, we should test all things. We should hold fast to what is good, and we should shun every form of evil. Now, what that means is, as Christians, we should examine everything against the Word of God. In other words, the desire of every Christian should be to know the truth and be able to proclaim it with authority. As Christians, we should know the truth against false doctrines. And as Christians, we should let no one deceive us. Now, I'd like to go through some examples of deception. And each one of these examples deals with the issue of time. What does the Bible have to say about time? What does the Bible have to say about the age of the earth? And let's compare and contrast that to what the world says using evolution. Now, when we deal with the issue of time, we saw in Genesis chapter 1 that every time we see a number with the word day, such as first day, second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day, sixth day, it always means a short period of time. It never means a long period of time. But God gave us more information. He actually defined the length of his days. He gives each day a definite beginning and a definite ending, where he states, evening and morning, first day, evening and morning, second day, evening and morning, third day. Everywhere we see the words evening and morning in the Old Testament, it only means a literal day. But yet we have many churches out there, many Christians still believing that maybe God could have used evolution. Well, first of all, that's a wrong statement for a Christian to make, because it's not a matter of what God could have done. It's a matter of what did he do, and what he did is clearly written in his word. And we read over and over again, God is the creator of all things. Now, if we want to adopt this idea that God used evolution, which also brings in the idea of millions of years of time, we must ask ourselves this question. What was going on for those millions of years before Adam and Eve came on board? And the answer would be millions of years of death, decay, and disease, because that is what the fossil record is. It's a record of dead things. Therefore, a belief in millions of years is a belief in death before sin. Now, we must ask this next question. If sin is not the cause of death, then why did Jesus Christ have to go to that cross, physically die on that cross, and physically raise from the dead and conquer death? You see, by adding millions of years into the Bible, we have lost our foundation for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Most of our Christian students still go to public schools today, and they get taught a completely different worldview from what the Bible teaches. They get a worldview called evolutionism. And what they get taught there are things like the origin of life, where they speculate that life originated about 3.5 billion years ago, all by naturalistic processes, and God had nothing to do with that. Well, there are many problems with that belief. First of all, the whole origin of life is nothing more than speculation. There's absolutely no evidence for how it could have happened. Secondly, one cell, and we have about 60 trillion of these in our body, is more complex than any machine mankind's ever made. Now, we also know that life cannot start in the presence of oxygen in the atmosphere. Why? Because oxygen destroys chemical bonds. They don't teach that in many of our schools. They also don't teach that life cannot start if there was no oxygen in the atmosphere. Because if there's no oxygen, there's no ozone, and we have no protection, and everything becomes instant crispy critters. They also don't teach that life cannot start in water. See, water, there's a process called hydrolysis, which literally means water splitting. See, what water does at the molecular level, it destroys chemical bonds. See, what they're really teaching in our schools is something called evolutionism and not the true science anymore. You see, Genesis is a very important book in the Bible. Genesis is foundational for almost every one of our Christian doctrines. Genesis gives us the answer for the sanctity of human life. Genesis gives us the foundation for marriage between one man and one woman. Genesis answers the question why we die. Genesis answers the question why we need a Savior. In other words, Genesis is the foundation for the gospel of Jesus Christ.
The teaching that there is one God is called monotheism. Orthodox biblical Christianity has always affirmed this teaching. The teaching that there are many gods is called polytheism. Christianity has always rejected polytheism. Pagan religions like Hinduism and non-Christian cults like Mormonism teach polytheism. Christianity doesn't. For example, Brigham Young, a leader of the Mormon cult, which teaches that Jesus and Satan are brothers and that salvation is by works, stated, quote, "How many gods there? I do not know. But there never was a time when there were not gods and worlds, and when men were not passing through the same ordeals, mortality, that we are now passing through. That course has been from all eternity, and it is and will be to all eternity," unquote. Now, concerning the biblical evidence affirming that there is one God, we see the following in Isaiah 43:10, quote, "Before me no God was formed, nor shall there be any after me," unquote. The Hebrew word for God here is El, the singular form of the same word these Word of Faith teachers often erroneously attach to themselves, Elohim. Thus, according to the true God, these people who God created are not gods. Case closed. So you have the Word of Faith teachers, the pagan religions, and the Mormons teaching polytheism, that they are gods and can become gods, and then you have Holy Scripture, which is clear on the issue of monotheism, thereby refuting any attempt to make people out to be gods. Another clear text which refutes the Word of Faith movement's little god teaching is Genesis 3, 4-5. In this text, God had just gotten through warning Adam and Eve not to eat of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, lest they die. Then Satan, or the devil, said to Eve, quote, "And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil," unquote. In verse 6, Eve, now deceived by this temptation of being as gods, ate from the tree along with her husband. This act of violating God's command then plunged humanity into sin to this day. The first one to teach that men shall be as gods was Satan himself. And yet the Word of Faith movement teaches that people are little gods, as if this is something coming from God. The quote-unquote grandfather of the Word of Faith movement, Kenneth Hagin, stated, quote, "You are as much the incarnation of God as Jesus Christ was. Every man who has been born again is an incarnation, and Christianity is a miracle. The believer is as much an incarnation as was Jesus of Nazareth," unquote.
Say after me, within me is a God-man. Say it again, within me is a God-man. Now let's say even better than that, let's say I am a God-man.
When you say I'm a Christian, you're saying I am Mashiach in Hebrew. I'm a little Messiah walking on earth, in other words. The new creation is just like God. May I say it like this? You are a little God on earth running around.
Not only does Hin teach this heretical doctrine, but he also teaches that those who correct him will die and that their children will die.
Let me say something else too, and I really don't care if you like this or not. You have attacked me, your children will pay for it. If you don't like it, it honestly don't matter with me.
I am a little God.
Yes. Yes.
So it's going to get big for some people. Get ready. Go ahead, email me now in that place. Go ahead. You tap into who you really are. You know what the Bible calls you? It says you are a little Elohim. You are a little God.
You don't have a God in you. You are one.
Although these people teach that humans are made in terms of quote-unquote equality with God, or the same quote-unquote class of being as God, as Hagin claims, the biblical view is quite different. For example, Jeremiah 10:6 states, quote, "There is none like you, O Lord, you are great, and your name is great in might," unquote. And with respect to the quote-unquote God class, Psalms 86:10 makes it quite clear that there is only one in it, quote, "For you are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God, Elohim," unquote. This is a clear rejection of the heretical idea that men are exact duplicates of God or little gods. In Acts 10:25-26, when Peter was allegedly born again and made a little god, he says something which destroys this heretic cult, quote, When Peter entered, Cornelius met him and fell down at his feet and worshipped him. But Peter lifted him up, saying, "Stand up, I too am a man," unquote. Notice, Peter wouldn't accept this customary bowing. Instead, he reminds Cornelius that he is merely a man.
Charismatic movement or Pentecostal movement or whatever you want to call it is not biblical. And let's understand what the Bible teaches about this doctrine and what the gift of tongues really is, as opposed to this counterfeit tongues movement. And many of them will say, if you don't speak in tongues, you're not saved, because that's the sign that would follow those that believe. Everybody needs to speak. If you haven't spoken in tongues, you need to come down the aisle and get right with God and speak in tongues. But he said that's what they believe. In the church, God said he gave different people different gifts. And that's just one of the gifts that he lists that's only given to certain people. Does this mean that they just said, No, what does it say? When it says that they spoke with other tongues, look at verse 5, and the explanation comes immediately. It says, and their practice. It says, there were Jews, devout men, out of every nation under heaven. Now, when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded. Confounded means confused. They're blown away. They can't understand it. It says, they were confounded because that every man heard them speak in his own language. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? And how hear we every man in our own tongue wherein we were born? So a minute ago it said they heard it in their own language. Now it's saying they heard it in their own tongue. And God even goes so far as to list the languages, just to make sure that we understand what tongues are. Tongues are foreign languages. Yeah. There are all these men from 17 or so different places that are listed, let alone the ones that are not listed, because it says every nation under heaven is represented. That are understanding these Galileans speaking in all these foreign languages. And what is it that confuses them or confounds them or astonishes them? It's not what they don't understand, it's what they do understand. So they're not just amazed that, wow, that guy's really talking some cool gibberish. I mean, that sounds cool. I mean, that's of the Spirit. No, they're saying, wow, I understand what that guy's saying. I traveled hundreds of miles to get here. I'm in a town where I wouldn't expect anybody to speak my language. And now I'm seeing these guys that are clearly Galileans and they're speaking my language. Now, what was the goal here? What was the purpose of this miracle? It was to get people saved, right? Because what are they preaching to them? The gospel. And they're hearing in their tongue the wonderful works of God. And so it was just amazing because they could hear the gospel in their own native language. And they glorified God for that. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. It says in verse 1, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not charity, I am become as sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. So this is where people start to bring in the wild doctrine. Because so far, everything's been so cut and dried. But here's where they want to move the goalposts and say, the tongues of angels. And say there's a heavenly angelic language. There's a language that's a celestial language, a prayer language, a special language that we humans don't know, and all, and they'll come up with this. So people will just take that and build an entire doctrine The primary application isn't to tell you, hey, you know there's a heavenly language, huh? You want to get in on this? You want to speak this? Has anything, have we heard anything about anywhere else in the whole Bible about heavenly languages that we want to get access to? No, because the gift of the Spirit, where they spoke with other tongues, they were speaking human tongues, and the purpose was so that people would understand them. Okay, so to sit there and say, well, no, angels speak a foreign language. So I guess when the angel shows up, you know, you better have an interpreter or God's going to have to perform some kind of a miracle for you to be able to communicate with those angels. This is just taking one verse, and this is how all false doctrine originates. Right. You take one verse, you don't apply it based on what it's actually talking about, the actual context. You just take an auxiliary point from that verse and just run with it and create a whole doctrine about a heavenly language, and if you're filled with the Spirit, you speak a heavenly language. No, that is not taught in the Bible. What if I read a chapter in the Bible out of the Hungarian Bible for you tonight? Would you, would God, I mean, God would bless his word in my heart, and I would understand, but you know, it'd be a waste unto the church. That's all he's saying here when he says, when you pray or prophesy in an unknown tongue. And look at the proof, okay? Because he says in verse 6, now, brethren, if I come unto you speaking with tongues, what shall I profit you except I shall speak to you either by revelation or by knowledge or by prophesying or by doctrine? And even things without life, this is verse 7, giving sound, whether pipe or harp, except they give a distinction in the sounds, how shall it be known what is piped or harped? For if the trumpet give an uncertain sound, who shall prepare himself to the battle? So likewise ye, except ye utter by the tongue words easy to be understood. How shall it be known what is spoken? For ye shall speak into the air. So he says, look, you show up and you speak in a language that the people around you in church don't understand. You're speaking into the air. You're not profiting anyone. Right. Now, what are they doing in the charismatic movement? Oh, praise the Lord, they're filled with the Spirit. No. Who are they edifying? What are they teaching? What are they preaching? And by the way, they don't even understand what they're saying many times. They'll tell you that. So hold on. Is that what the Bible's teaching? That people will say things and they won't even understand what they're saying? They don't even know what they're talking about? No. Because the spirit of the prophets is subject to the prophets. And in Acts chapter 2, they knew what gospel they were presenting. You say, Pastor Anderson, your this is what people would say to this. Pastor Anderson, your interpretation of this is ridiculous because nobody in the world would ever go to a church where they speak a foreign language that nobody understands. It's about this kind. Woo! That's what it's about. It's about, you know, that's what it's about. No. Because guess what? There are people who go to church in a foreign language that they don't understand. Let me introduce you to hundreds of millions of them. They're called Roman Catholics. Hello, is anybody out there? The Roman Catholic Church has been getting up, and now they're starting to do it as they've modernized. They're starting to do it in English and do it in. We're talking about the church that burned people at the stake for teaching their children the Lord's Prayer in the English language because you got to speak Latin. And we're talking about hundreds of millions of people who showed up to church and it was all Pax Vobiscum, blah, 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 and they have no idea what's even being said. And the priest's understanding is unfruitful. Of course, he doesn't understand anything anyway. But I don't care what kind of mysteries and prophecies he's speaking, if it's in Latin. I mean, there are people who sit and listen to the whole Mass in Latin, every word of it. To this day, there are hardcore Catholic churches that do it in Latin. It's not just so you can go to a service, have an emotional experience, and impress people. Everybody, I'm spiritual. Here's the proof. Blah, 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 you know. Everybody see I'm filled with the Spirit? Everybody see that? No, it doesn't make any sense. It's not edifying anyone.
Before the 3rd century, the church in Rome was one of many churches that were scattered all over the Roman Empire. The reason the church in Rome later became the head of all the churches of the world and dominated the Middle Ages was because it joined hands with Emperor Constantine. After the church in Rome accepted pagan idolatry and doctrines, it was quickly secularized. During the Middle Ages, it was even hard to tell the difference between the church and the secular world. An indulgence is a certificate giving the forgiveness of sins. The Catholic priest propagated that people were guaranteed to enter the kingdom of heaven safer when they gave more money.
Come, see for yourself. This is not just a simple indulgence. Even though you don't do confession, all your sins will be forgiven. Even the sins of your relatives in purgatory will vanish. Will you just leave your mother to suffer in the fire? Come here, everyone. Come. When you drop the coins in the box and it makes a clinking sound, then the souls will arise from the fiery purgatory.
The sale of indulgence was one of the biggest businesses of the Catholic Church. Since indulgences was a good solution for those who were seized by the fear of hell, numerous people gathered to buy the kingdom of heaven. The Bible teaches that only God can forgive sins. However, the Catholic Church insists that the Pope too has the authority to forgive sins. This kind of false teaching enabled them to commit fraud, the sale of indulgences.
Now, there's an agenda today, and it's a satanic agenda to change the Bible. A lot of people just think, well, the King James Bible is a great translation. It's very poetic, and these other versions are inferior. Maybe they're not as well translated. But I'm here to tell you, it goes much deeper than that. These new versions are actually Satan's attempt at corrupting the Word of God. I'm going to show you that these changes are not just accidental, they're not just minor, inconsequential changes. I mean, these changes are strategic changes. They are calculated to attack specific doctrines that the Bible teaches. The Bible tells in Ephesians 6:12, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." There are people who have many millions and even billions of dollars who have an agenda to put out corrupted Bibles and then promote them through advertising, promote them through retail stores that will put them front and center, and that will show people this is the Bible you ought to be reading. Get rid of the King James Bible, get the newer, better, improved version. The NIV is missing 16 entire verses from the New Testament. I mean, just right out of the gate, before we talk about all the thousands of changes, just 16 verses are completely missing. Matthew 17, 21, gone. Matthew 18, 11, gone. Acts 8, 37, that verse is gone from the NIV, gone from the ESV, gone from the New Living Translation, completely gone. But not only have they removed 16 entire verses from the NIV, they also put notes on 27 other verses saying, these verses were probably not in the original. Again, causing you to doubt God's word. Verses like Mark 16, 15, go ye therefore into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Verses like, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. They haven't removed these verses, but they've put a note next to it that renders it in the reader's mind null and void, saying, well, this probably wasn't in the original anyway. This doesn't really have any authority anyway. We believe that Jesus Christ was God in the flesh. Amen. This is something that these modern versions constantly change and attack. Let me give you some examples. 1 John 5, 7, for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. That's where we get the word Trinity. Three in one. These three are one. The NIV, on the other hand, just says, for there are three that testify. Doesn't mention the Father, doesn't mention the Word, doesn't mention the Holy Ghost, and does not mention that the three are one. Look what they've done with 1 Timothy 3:16. The Bible reads, and without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. Watch this. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the Spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory. It was God that was believed on in the world. It was God that was received up into glory. It was God who was made flesh and dwelt among us. And the Bible is crystal clear in 1 Timothy 3:16 that Jesus Christ is God. Another great proof of the fact that Jesus Christ is God is Hebrews 1:8. But unto the Son he saith, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. So what is the Bible calling the Son there? It's calling him God. It says, unto the Son, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. Listen to the NIV. But about the Son, he says.
Recently, I was talking to a Jehovah's Witness in the train station. I went to pick my wife up. Mm-hmm. And the Jehovah's Witness was starting to read to me out of a devotional book she had, but I saw her New World Translation. Mm-hmm. So I said, well, is the New World Translation from the Greek? She said, it's from the Westcott-Hort Greek New Testament. Mm-hmm. I said, is it accurate? She said, of course. I said, have you had Greek? She said, no. I said, what would you do if Jehovah himself spoke to Jesus and called him God? Hmm. That never happened. So I quoted for her Hebrews 1:8. Under the Son, he saith, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. Uh-huh. She became so excited, so upset, she took her bags and rolled out the door, and I followed her out the door talking to her. But when I read it from the New World Translation later, it completely has been changed. Hmm.
Whereas in the King James, you can't misunderstand it. But not only that, but they attack Christ's virgin birth. Go to Luke chapter 2:33. The Bible says, and Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. The NIV, on the other hand, and the ESV, and the New Living Translation say, the child's father and mother marveled at what was said about him. So right there, we see that the NIV and these other modern versions are calling Joseph the father of Jesus Christ, something that the King James Bible is careful to never do. In fact, later in this same chapter, Mary refers to Joseph as Jesus' father, and he corrects her immediately. It says, when they saw him, they were amazed, and his mother said unto him, son, why hast thou thus dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing. So didn't she just refer to Joseph as Jesus' father? Watch how he immediately corrects her. And he said unto them, how is it that ye sought me? Wist ye not that I must be about my father's business? He's saying, look, I'm about my father's business when I'm preaching the word of God, because Joseph is not my father. God the Father is my father. People who believe the NIV, they're so blinded. I've actually had them show me this and say, see, this is the Bible calling Joseph Jesus' father. No, that's Mary calling Joseph Jesus' father. And she's immediately rebuked, and somebody needs to rebuke the NIV. Yeah. Somebody needs to correct the New Living Translation. Somebody needs to rebuke the ESV and say, wait a minute, you're wrong. That is not Jesus' father. Jesus' father is God the Father. You say, well, they're just a little easier to understand. Well, the changes don't really affect doctrine. These are some pretty important doctrines, aren't they? The deity of Christ, the virgin birth. Not only that, they attack his eternal pre-existence. See, Jesus Christ did not come into being in Bethlehem's manger. Jesus Christ did not come into being in the womb of Mary, but rather Jesus Christ has always existed and always will exist. He is the first and the last. He is the Alpha and Omega. He is the beginning and the ending, and that's crucial to his deity. If he's a created being, he can't be God. The Bible says in Micah 5:2, but thou Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall come forth unto me that is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from of old, watch this, from everlasting. So here in Micah 5:2, the Bible tells us that Jesus Christ is from everlasting. Those are two very powerful words because they speak to the eternal pre-existence of Jesus Christ. He had no beginning. He is not a created being. He was God in the flesh. He was in the beginning with God, and he was God. Now, everlasting means it goes on forever, it lasts forever. So from everlasting would be something that comes from the eternal past or something that comes from the infinite past, something that has always existed. Listen to the NIV. But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, watch this, whose origins are from of old, from ancient times. Now, what's an origin? That's when something starts to exist, isn't it? When something originates, that's when it starts to exist. Look, did Jesus start to exist at some point? No, he's from everlasting in the King James Bible. But according to the NIV, he had an origin. If Jesus Christ had an origin, then he's not God, because God was and is to come. God has always existed. God is not a created being.
The only way you and I know that Satan's name is Lucifer is because of Isaiah 14:12. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer? Now I want you to notice, it gives us his name and it gives us his title. O Lucifer, son of the morning. So what's the title of Lucifer? Son of the morning, right? Revelation chapter 22, verse 16. The King James Version says this, I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am, this is Jesus speaking, I am the root and the offspring of David, this is Jesus speaking, and the bright and morning star. Do you see that? What did Jesus call himself? The morning star. That's his title.
So both the King James and the NIV in Revelation 22, 16 state that Jesus Christ is the morning star.
What does the NIV call Lucifer falling down from heaven?
How you have fallen from heaven, morning star, son of the dawn. So instead of Lucifer being cast out of heaven in Isaiah 14:12, in the NIV, you have Jesus being cast out of heaven. Now look, the Bible has told us that Lucifer or Satan was cast out of heaven for wanting to be like the Most High, wanting to be like God. Look, the NIV, after attacking Christ's deity, after attacking his pre-existence, after attacking the fact that he was born of a virgin, that he had no beginning, that he had no ending, that he was God in the flesh, it's now accusing him of wanting to be like the Most High. He is the Most High. The people who are behind these versions are of Satan. Satan wanted to corrupt the word in the Garden of Eden, and we are not ignorant of his devices. See, the Word of God has great power. The Bible reads in Hebrews 4:12, for the Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. The devil knows that if he can disarm us as Christians, he can defeat us.
You gotta understand this. The enemy is constantly trying to take your weapon away, not to defend you, but so that you cannot defend yourself. Say, why? Is there an attack under the Word of God today? Of course there is. Because if Satan can disarm you from the one thing you've got to hurt him, from the one thing you've got to engage him in battle, if he can disarm you, then it's easy pickings.
The devil would love nothing more than to take the two-edged sword of the King James Bible out of our hand and replace it with a butter knife called the NIV. replace it with a butter knife called the ESV, replace it with a butter knife called the New King James. He doesn't want us to be armed. He doesn't want us to be able to do battle with the rulers of the darkness of this world. When we look at the Bible versions that led up to the King James, Tyndale, Matthew, Coverdale, Great Bible, Bishop's Bible, Geneva Bible, they all line up with the King James. They all basically say the same thing as the King James. The King James Bible is the culmination of the Bibles that preceded it. So if the King James Bible is consistent with all the other English Bibles that led up to it, why are these modern Bibles so different? Two men by the names of Westcott and Hort put together a critical text mainly based on two manuscripts known as Sinaiticus or Codex Aleph and Vaticanus or Codex B. And these two manuscripts were thought by Westcott and Hort to be older and therefore more reliable than the other Greek texts that had been used in the Textus Receptus. The modern Bibles are supposedly the result of modern archaeology and modern scholarship and modern discovery. I mean, even the people who promote these modern Bibles will tell you, well, the modern publishers just have more resources available to them today. They just have manuscripts that just weren't available to the King James translators. That's why the modern Bibles are better, they'll say. And the reason they say that is because the manuscripts that the modern Bibles are translated from, the NIV, etc., are newer discoveries, meaning that they were buried for centuries. Yeah. Now let me ask you something. Do you believe that the true Bible was buried for centuries? I mean, do you really think that God would allow his people to be using the wrong Bible for hundreds and hundreds of years, and then all of a sudden in the 1800s, we're going to find the right manuscripts? It doesn't make any sense. I mean, God promised to preserve his word to all generations, but they're basically believing that God's word in its true form was buried somewhere. And that for all these centuries, everybody is reading and preaching and believing something that's wrong. And then thank God for the archaeology of the 1800s to dig up these new manuscripts, the true word of God that's been buried for all this. Look, if God took so much time and effort to bring us the word of God through all the prophets and holy men of God who spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost over the course of hundreds, yea, thousands of years, and then he just lets it get buried? No, these ones that have been dug up of late, these newer, better manuscripts, are fraudulent. They have names like Codex Vaticanus. Now, what does that call to mind? Codex Vaticanus.
Because it was found in the Vatican or it's Vatican related, to me makes it immediately suspect.
Right.
There are more than 5,200 Greek fragments and portions of the New Testament that are available for study.
Wow.
And 45 of those are the predominant texts that are used by translators for any outside the King James Bible.
Okay.
That's 1% of the manuscripts available. Where the King James Bible uses 99.06% of those 5,255 texts to translate from. And this is why it's partly called the majority text.
Right.
You have to also note, and I don't think this is mentioned that often, in the Gospels themselves, between Sinaiticus and also the Vaticanus, there are over 3,000 differences. So how do we know which one is the correct difference or the correct passage that should be used unless it's validated by the other 43 sources that they use? But if I have two manuscripts, A and B, that are in conflict just in the Gospels in 3,000 places, how do I know which one is reliable?
Right.
So I'd rather trust in the predominance of manuscripts that gave us the Textus Receptus.
They're basically rejecting thousands of Bibles in all different languages that are all saying the same thing. Instead, they're going to go with Codex Vaticanus, Codex Sinaiticus, just because they're supposedly older. Okay, but just because they're older doesn't mean that they're right. It doesn't mean that they're not fraudulent. Look, Paul told us in 2 Corinthians 2 that people were corrupting the word of God even in his day. In 2 Thessalonians, they were already writing a false scripture pretending to be from the Apostle Paul. In Revelation 22, God was already warning people who would try to take away from or add to God's word. So that's already been taking place. So just because you got a manuscript that's from 200 years after Christ, oh, there's no way it could be tampered with, right? Of course it could. And there are many, the Bible tells us, that corrupt the word of God. Not a few, but many. You might not think that the NIV is a Catholic Bible, and they'll tell, oh, it's evangelical, it's for Baptists. But you know what? I'm going to show you all the Catholic doctrines that it props up because it's from these Catholic manuscripts. Acts 8:37 has been removed from the modern Bible versions because it condemns infant baptism.
This is why we don't do infant baptism. You know why? Because according to the Bible, what's stopping me from getting baptized? You got to believe and then be baptized. An infant can't believe. An infant's not even condemned. Infant dies, they go to heaven. But a Catholic could read that and say, well, infant baptism, go ahead. What's stopping you from getting baptized? Nothing. Let's just baptize him. No, something is stopping you from getting baptized. It's believing. It's just missing in your Bible.
The Catholics teach a doctrine that Mary was still a virgin all the way throughout her life. Now, we know that, of course, Mary was a virgin when she gave birth to Jesus Christ. But the Bible is clear that after that, she had other children. In fact, it lists four of Jesus' half-brothers, James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon. He gives the names of the brothers, and then it says, his sisters, are they not all with us? So Jesus had at least seven half-siblings, maybe even more. Now, here's a great proof of that in Matthew 1:25. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. So it doesn't say that he never knew her. It just says that he knew her not until she had brought forth her firstborn son. It says in verse 25 in the NIV, but he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. What's missing? Firstborn. If Jesus is the firstborn son of Mary, that tells me there's a secondborn. But the NIV removes that so you can say, well, you know, that was the only son that she had. Another doctrine of the Catholic Church that is supported by the NIV is the doctrine of beating yourself. And yes, you've heard me correctly, self-flagellation or beating yourself. Now, your Catholic friends that you know in the United States probably do not beat themselves. But throughout history, the Roman Catholic Church has taught and encouraged the practice of beating yourself, okay? In fact, when Henry VIII made Catholicism illegal in England and kicked the Roman Catholic Church out of England, he also at the same time passed a law against beating yourself. And even today in the Philippines, the devout Catholics will beat themselves today in 2013. In the Philippines, they crucify themselves, they beat themselves, they crawl on their knees till they're bleeding. I mean, they do these type of acts to themselves. Look what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 9:27. But I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. The NIV says, I beat my body. Okay, the Amplified Version. I don't know about you, but the Amplified Version was always too loud for me. You know, that's, I never even got. But anyway, listen to the Amplified Version. But like a boxer, I buffet my body. Now, let me ask this. Have you ever known a boxer who beats himself up? Because I haven't. The Common English Bible really, really makes it easy to understand for you. Because isn't that why you like these new versions? Because they're easy to understand. Rather, I'm landing punches on my own body and subduing it like a slave. Look, beating yourself is not a biblical doctrine. And you say, well, he's just meaning it figuratively. Well, what about all these people who actually beat themselves? It's a strange doctrine, my friend. I don't believe in it. The Bible says in Matthew 6:7, but when ye pray, use not vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. So the Bible's teaching us here not to just vainly repeat things over and over again, thinking that if we say something over and over again, God's going to hear us, more than if we just said it once. What's a repetition? Saying the same thing twice, or three times, or five times. He's saying, look, don't use vain repetitions as the heathen do. Okay, the NIV, on the other hand, and all the modern versions pretty much change this. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they'll be heard because of their many words. Babble is when you're just talking about meaningless things and going on and on and on, just blathering. It's not the same as vain repetitions. If I said to a Roman Catholic, you know, you're repeating the same prayer of the Our Father over and over and over and over, you're not going to be heard for your much speaking. That's a vain repetition. You need to say that one time and be done with it and not just keep repeating the same thing over and over again. You know, that's supported by Matthew 6:7. But if I say to them, hey, stop babbling like a pagan, they're going to say, well, this isn't Babel. Right. They're going to say the Lord's Prayer is God's word. Because it is God's word, right? But I'm not going to chant that or repeat that in a vain way to God. But the Catholic Church teaches vain repetitions, so that alteration has been made. Not only that, but the Catholics have a very strong doctrine of confessing your sins to the priest. And they'll take you to James 5:15. And in the Catholic Bible, there's a note in the column that says, hey, this verse is telling you to confess your sins to the priest. It says that, for example, in the Douay Rheims Catholic Bible, in the notes, that's what it says. James 5:16, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Now listen to what the NIV and the modern versions change this to. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. That's the NIV. Now you say, well, that's the same thing, but it's not the same thing. First of all, if you go back to the original language, if you go back to what it actually says in the Greek, the word is fault, it's not sin.
In the Textus Receptus, It uses the word for faults, paroptomata, Which comes from paroptoma, which means faults. And I think sometimes people, when they read the wrong thing there, That they're too busy confessing their sins to men rather than their sins to the God. Because If we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins And to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Mm-hmm. Whereas I confess my faults to you when I might say, I'm weak in this one area of my life, I need to be strengthened, will you pray for me? So when I confess my fault to you, I'm not going to confession, nor am I confessing my sin to you, But I'm confessing the faults and weaknesses that I have personally. So there is a difference in the understanding of the words between sin and faults themselves.
Right. Evangelical Christianity historically has not accepted Catholicism as being true Christianity. It used to be when I was a child that the Christian bookstore would have books and literature exposing the Catholic Church, warning you about the Catholic Church. Now you go to a Christian bookstore and they have rosary beads, they sell Catholic Bibles, they sell Catholic paraphernalia. What we're seeing is a blurring of the lines between evangelical Christianity and Roman Catholicism. People are being prepared for a one-world religion that unites Catholicism, all denominations of Christianity, in fact, all religions of the world.
Those who push for a global religious organization believe that all religions, while different on the surface, are each valid pathways to God.
Instead of all these different gods, maybe there's one God who manifests himself and revealed himself in different ways to different people. You know, what about that, huh?
Do we all worship the same God, Christian and Muslim?
I think we do.
Does?
We have different routes of getting to the Almighty.
Do Christians and non-Christians, do Muslims go to heaven, in your mind?
Yes, they do. We have different routes of getting there.
I think everybody that loves Christ or knows Christ, whether they're conscious of it or not, they're members of the body of Christ. And that's what God is doing today. He's calling people out of the world for His name, whether they come from the Muslim world or the Buddhist world or the Christian world or the non-believing world. They are members of the body of Christ because they've been called by God. They may not even know the name of Jesus, but they know in their heart that they need something that they don't have, and they turn to the only light that they have. And I think that they are saved and that they're going to be with us in heaven.
Until I die, I'll proclaim nothing but love for all my brothers and sisters in Christ, my Catholic brothers and sisters, Protestant brothers and sisters, Christian Reformers, Lutherans, I don't care what label you are.
And you know, Jack, there are so many other Protestant ministers who are doing the same thing as you.
Yes.
You're comfortable with the Vatican?
Oh, I'm very comfortable with the Vatican. I've been to see the Pope several times.
They believe in Christ. They believe in the death of Christ on the cross and His resurrection. I feel that I belong to all the churches. I'm equally at home in an Anglican or Baptist church or Brethren Assembly or Roman Catholic church.
You know what? We don't all have the same views, and I realize Mormonism is not traditional Christianity, but I'm probably a little broader and more open in the fact that when somebody loves Jesus and believes they're the Son of God, that's good for me.
Robert McGinnis with the Family Research Council says it appears the hidden agenda is to unite people under one religious organization so they will peacefully accept UN goals such as population control, abortion rights, and one world government.
They are all coming together as one under the authority of Lucifer.
The devil knows that in order to get people to accept the New World Order, to accept false religion, he has to make changes very slowly. He's not going to jerk the steering wheel. The devil is slowly chipping away at the foundations of our religion. The devil is slowly chipping away at the foundation of the Word of God. He's slowly chipping away at true biblical Christianity so that he can replace it with a new global religion where the Antichrist will be worshiped as the Lord Jesus Christ.
Do you believe that modern Bible versions are going to play a role in that new world order?
Well, I think it's very possible, because the more translations that come out, the more liberal they seem to become, and more acceptable to the general population. But there's over 200 now, 200 plus.
Right.
And in these translations now, we have people throwing in translations for those who are gay and lesbian. Mm-hmm. We have people throwing in translations that are removing he or she, making it it. So I think in the modern translations and the ones that are coming out that are becoming more and more liberal, allows all faiths of all different types of people and beliefs to come together and not be offended by any particular thing. That's ecumenical in nature.
Right.
So ecumenism is part and parcel with the end times.
Right.
The King James Bible uses the word hell 54 times. I mean, when you read the Old Testament in the NIV, there's not even one mention of the word hell. You don't even read the word hell in the NIV until you get to the book of Matthew. Now, supposedly, these new versions are being written so that they'll be easier to understand. And yet, if we were to ask anybody on the street what hell is, they would be able to tell us that hell is a place of fire and torment. It's a place where people go after they die to be punished and to suffer. If we ask them what Sheol means, most people aren't going to know.
What does the word Sheol mean?
Sheol? Sheol means a protective cover.
Say it again.
Sheol.
Say it again. What, spell it out.
S-H-E-O. I'm not sure on that. No.
Okay.
No.
No.
No, I do not.
No.
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 I don't know.
S what?
S-H-E-O-L. Sheol?
No. Oh, Sheol, no. Not.
Can't remember off the top of my head.
S-H-E-O-L?
Right.
I'm not sure. I've never seen that word.
No, I'm not so familiar with that.
Okay, yeah.
Most people aren't familiar with that word. Do you think that those words are easier than the word hell?
No.
Okay. I believe that the King James Bible is the Word of God. I believe that it's without error, and I believe that the other versions that are coming out, you know, the NIV, the New American Standard, that they're bad, that they're of the devil. In your book, it seems that you don't see at all that there could be anything nefarious behind any of these changes. You seem to not believe that the devil would ever tamper with his word, or that any of these changes were nefarious, that any of the textual variances have to do with a guy who says, I'm going to change this because I'm evil.
Yeah,
because I want to change God's word.
I actually believe God has protected his word.
But you don't believe that there's and for example, you use the term conspiracy theorist probably 20 times in your book. Do you believe that there's no conspiracy to change God's word?
No, I think entire Bible translations exist today to change God's word.
But could they have existed back then also? If there are people today who are putting out something like the New World Translation, which is clearly a perversion of God's word, do you agree?
Yep.
Okay. So if people are perverting God's word today with the New World Translation, for example, they were perverting God's word in Paul's day. He warned about it. Mm-hmm. Why do you not believe that people were perverting God's word in the 3rd, 4th century, 8th century, 9th century?
We know that the New World Translation is a perversion of God's word. Mm-hmm. It is easy to detect. The reason I used conspiracy theory is that you have to have evidence to back these things up, not just, well, it looks like that to me. Mm-hmm. You know, the only places where the New World Translation mistranslates stuff is that the very issues with Watchtower Bible and Tract Society happens to disagree with biblical Christianity.
You must not have read Job 6, verse 6 in the New World Translation.
Why?
Then. Because in Job 6, 6, in the King James Bible, it says, can that which is unsavory be eaten without salt? And is there any taste in the white of an egg? And in the New World Translation, it says, is there any taste in the slimy juice of the marshmallow? So that's something that they changed that has nothing to do with the Watchtower, all right? So what I'm saying there is that,
you know, memorized that?
Could there be?
Yes, I did. You memorized that? I didn't even know marshmallow had slimy juice.
I mean, if you have a New World Translation, I'd be glad to show it to you, but you believe me.
Oh, but did you know something? There's a new edition just came out last week.
I bet it still says marshmallow, but I'll check.
I will have to look.
But here's my point with that, though. What about all the people out there, and you've heard this a million times, I've heard it a million times, that tell you, oh, the Bible's filled with contradictions.
So I hear it all the time.
Couldn't there be an agenda to create contradictions? Just to make, or just to put stupid things in the Bible.
No,
just to put things in the Bible that sound stupid. Like, Saul was, what about this? Saul was 1 year old when he began to reign.
1 Samuel 13:1 in the King James Version says, Saul reigned 1 year, and when he had reigned 2 years over Israel. In the English Standard Version, that's changed to Saul lived for 1 year and then became king.
1 Samuel 13:1 in the Douay Rheims Version, which is the Catholic Bible, Saul was a child of 1 year when he began to reign, and he reigned 2 years over Israel.
You know what that verse just told us? That Saul was a 1 year old when he became a king. Here's the problem. 1 Samuel 9:2 says, from his shoulders and upward, he was higher than any other people. Well, according to the English Standard Version, he was 1 year old when he was head and shoulders above all the men. That was one big baby. I'm just trying to tell you, these Bibles are dumb. Sometimes I'm out soul winning and people will say to me, I don't believe the Bible because there's mistakes in the Bible. And I'll say, show me one. And they'll pull out an NIV. I'll say, don't show me. I could show you mistakes in that thing. I could show you contradictions in that thing. Show me one in the King James Bible. You won't find one.
Here's another change that the modern versions make. Galatians chapter 5. I would they were even cut off which trouble you. The NIV says, as for those agitators, I wish they would go the whole way and emasculate themselves. Now, does that sound like something that the Bible would teach, that the Apostle Paul would say? And you say, well, I don't think that's what they meant in the NIV. Well, is that why the Common English Bible translated it, I wish that the ones who are upsetting you would castrate themselves? Or how about the Contemporary English Version, the CEV? I've seen this one on sale at the Christian bookstore. I wish that everyone who is upsetting you would not only get circumcised, but would cut off much more. I mean, are you listening to this? Because this term cut off has nothing to do with being emasculated or castrated or mutilating yourself. Paul is referring back to these Old Testament scriptures about people who disobey God's word, that they would be cut off. Look, I don't have time to show you all the 100 and some examples of this. All he's saying there is that they need to be kicked out. He wished that they'd be cut off. He wished that they would be destroyed by God. That's what cut off means. They're going to be either destroyed by God, or cut off can mean that they need to be kicked out of the congregation, kicked out of the assembly, kicked out of the nation of Israel. That's the term cut off. But these weirdos with their modern versions are having the Apostle Paul saying, man, I wish those guys would just emasculate themselves. I wish they'd all castrate themselves. I wish they'd all mutilate themselves. I mean, that is not what he was teaching at all. Very strange indeed. But not only do these new versions contain a lot of crazy things that make the Bible look foolish, they also have a very specific agenda to prepare people for the New World Order. And part of that preparation is to convince Christians to obey the government no matter what. The key passage that they've tampered with is Romans 13.
I'm free to make myself a slave. I'm free to give up some of my freedom. I'm free, but I'm free to submit to the authority of my government. Even bad governments do God's work by keeping even a semblance of order in the streets. Even the government of the Soviet Union under Stalin was doing work for God. Even China under Mao Zedong was doing work for God. Honor the king. Do it anyway, whether the king deserves it or not. Honor your governor. Honor your mayor, whether or not they deserve it. Honor the king.
No one will be able to be armed. We will take all weapons. Sir.
Today in New Orleans, they got a lot tougher on the holdouts.
Police department at your home!
Not only the flooded areas, but New Orleans' driest and wealthiest neighborhoods, too.
But gun confiscation is exactly what happened during the state of emergency following Hurricane Katrina in New Orleans. U.S. troops also arrived, Easing public fears and quelling dissent would be critical. And that's exactly what the clergy response team, as it's called, helped accomplish in New Orleans.
The primary thing that we say to anybody is let's cooperate and get this thing over with, and then we'll settle the differences once the crisis is over.
Such clergy response teams would walk a tightrope between the needs of the government versus the wishes of the public. For the clergy, one of the biggest tools that they will have in helping calm the public down or obey the law is the Bible itself, specifically Romans 13.
Because the government is established by the Lord. And that's what we believe in the Christian faith. That's what's stated in the scripture.
But wait a minute. What if a police officer just comes to my house and says, wash my car, slave? Does the Bible require me to obey that?
No.
Okay, what if a police officer asked me to do something illegal? I mean, what if a policeman came to me and said, you know what? I want you to climb over the fence into your neighbor's house, and I want you to look through the window and see what your neighbor's doing. I want you to spy on your neighbor for me. I mean, do I have to obey that? Or what if you say, you're picking stupid examples. Right, because there's never been a government anywhere that commanded people to spy on their neighbors or else. That's never happened. Right? There's no such thing as Nazi Germany. There's no such thing as the Soviet Union. Just shut up and obey what you're told. Romans 13 is a passage that explains to us the purpose of government is to punish evildoers. Not to regulate every aspect of our lives and tell us what to do and control us. But also a key thing that is taught in Romans 13 is that we are to obey the higher powers. So for example, in the United States, we have various levels of government, don't we? Now, what is the supreme law of our land? Well, first of all, it's God's law. First, we obey God. After that is the Constitution of the United States, because the Constitution of the United States is the supreme law of the land. Say, well, the Bible says to honor the king, therefore we need to obey Obama. Well, hold on a second. Is Obama the king? Is our government run as a monarchy? And I thought that we have elected officials that answer to the people and that they are not above the law and that the supreme law of the land is the U.S. Constitution. So if we're going to obey the government that has been set up over us, if we're to obey the law of the land, that means we're supposed to obey the Constitution. The NIV just completely eliminates that teaching. It doesn't teach you to go with the higher power. It just says this. Everyone must submit to governing authorities. So instead of saying, you know, let every soul be subject unto the higher powers, there's no power but of God, the powers that be are ordained of God, just referring to the fact that no one on this earth has any legitimate authority except coming from God. Why do children have to obey their parents? Because God said so. Why do we obey human government at all? Why do we even have any respect for human government? Because God told us that human government is something that we need to punish evildoers, to protect the innocent from those that would harm them. Here's the New Living Translation in Romans 13:1. Everyone must submit to the governing authorities, for all authority comes from God. Watch this. And those in positions of authority have been placed there by God. Now, that is not true. The New Living Translation is saying that everyone in any position of authority has been placed there by God. That is not true. Because one day, the Antichrist is going to be placed in authority by Satan. The dragon gave him his authority, it says in Revelation 13. And not only that, but in Hosea, it says, they've set up kings, but not by me. There are times when human authority has been placed there by man against the will of God. And so, therefore, the New Living Translation is saying in verse 6, pay your taxes, too, for the same reasons. For government workers need to be paid. They're serving God in what they do. Give to them what you owe them. Pay your taxes and government fees to those who collect them. Good night. Now it's not just the tax, it's also the fees. And those are the worst. The King James is telling you to obey government within a certain scope, within certain parameters of what their job is, what they're supposed to be doing. And also, the whole concept of higher powers is there as a check and balance.
Why isn't the New King James inspired? Because it uses the same manuscripts.
Well, it doesn't. And there are many places where the New King James departs from the Textus Receptus and departs from what the King James is saying.
Not in the New Testament.
It does, actually. Yeah, there are actually a lot of places where it departs from the TR.
The New King James is probably one of the most dangerous versions out there. Because it leads you to think, oh, it's the same as the King James, it's just more modern, updated words. If that's all it was, I wouldn't even bring it up.
Because a lot of people who wouldn't touch the NIV with a 10-foot pole, They wouldn't touch the ESV or the New Living Translation with a 10-foot pole. But they say, come on, Pastor Anderson, the New King James. It's pretty much the same as the King James. It just gets rid of the these and the thous. It's just like the King James, except a little easier to understand. Okay, well, let me give you some stats on the New King James. The New King James omits the word Lord 66 times. It removes the word God 51 times. It removes the word heaven 50 times. It removes the word repent 44 times. The blood is removed 23 times. The word hell is removed 22 times, and he completely removes the word Jehovah, completely removes the word damnation, completely removes the term New Testament, completely removes the word devils. The Bible's not obsolete. You just need to get some smarts. You need to do some studying. You need to learn the language. And it's funny how my little children can understand it. And you're an adult and you can't understand it? And isn't it funny how the same people that say the King James is too hard to understand tell you you need to learn Greek if you really want to know what the Bible says? Yeah, that's really going to be easy to understand. The King James is too hard for you. Here's a Greek New Testament. These people are nuts. So let's check out some verses and see which one's easier to understand. The King James used a really hard word about a kind of tree, an oak. So the New King James thought, wow, that's way too hard. Oak? Are you serious? They changed it to terebinth tree. That's a little easier to understand, right? Now, Judges 8:13 contains a really tough phrase in the King James. The sun was up. Okay, I mean, that almost could be in Hop on Pop. The sun was up. They changed that to the ascent of Heres. The ascent of Heres. 1 Samuel 13:21, the King James used a really tough word, file. So the New King James changed that to PIM, P-I-M, PIM. I mean, that's probably good to know for Scrabble, but I've never heard of that word. Okay. 1 Samuel 22:6 uses this really hard word, tree. So the New King James decided to update that to tamarisk tree to make it a little bit easier to understand. 2 Samuel 6:5, the King James says cornet. Who knows what a cornet is? It's a type of horn, right? It's a type of trumpet. So they decided to use an easier word, sistrums. Sistrums, because everybody knows what sistrums mean. Who knows what sistrums means? Who knows what cornet means? There you go. Isaiah 13:12 used the difficult word man in your King James Bible. I mean, good night. Put the King James in a museum where it belongs. Man? Give me something I can understand. Mortal is way better, right? Daniel 6:2 used a really tough word, princes. So they used the easy word in the New King James, satraps. Band? Band in the King James, that's way too hard. Let's change it to regiment. Okay, and nobody's gonna understand what quicksand means. That's so obsolete. Quicksands in Acts 27:17? Syrtis sands is a lot easier to understand. You better get a New King James, much easier to understand. Is the New King James really that much easier to understand than the King James? I mean, that was a lot of examples where the King James is a lot easier. And that wasn't a complete list. That was just a bunch of examples. So it really has nothing to do with making it easier to understand. It just has to do with changing it. Corrupting it, twisting it, perverting it. The only thing that they can really point to and say, well, this is where we made it a lot easier, is getting rid of the these and the thous. But you got to have the these and the thous. Because the these and the thous are singular, and the you, ye, your is plural. The ones that start with a TH are singular. The ones that start with a Y are plural. It affects the meaning. Because you often would have no way of knowing whether he's talking to one person or the whole group, unless you had the these and the thous there to tell you that. It's important. It's all important. But let me just show you some doctrinal changes that the New King James make that pervert doctrine. Go to 1 Corinthians 1:18.
For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God.
Brother Garrett, read that for me nice and loud in the New King James.
For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God.
So notice, in the King James, it said that we are saved. In the New King James, it said we're being saved. Big difference, because salvation is not a process. Salvation happens in a moment of time, in a moment in the twinkling of an eye. We believe on Christ and we are passed from death to life. It's not a process. I'm not being saved. I done been saved. Amen. 2 Corinthians 2:15 says this, "For we are unto God a sweet savor of Christ in them that are saved and in them that perish." Read it for me from the New King James.
"For we are to God the fragrance of Christ among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing."
Again, not that are saved, but those who are being saved, as if it's a process. Matthew 7:14, for example, in the New King James says, "Difficult is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it." The King James says narrow, referring to how many people are going, referring to the fact that there are few that be saved. The New King James says it's difficult. Now, if it were by works, it would be difficult. Hey, Jesus did the hard part. How hard is it to accept a gift? How hard is it to take a drink of water? How hard is it to walk through a door? How hard is it to eat a piece of bread? These are the things that Jesus compared salvation to, because it's easy to be saved because you don't have to work your way to heaven. You know what salvation is referred to in the Bible as in the book of Hebrews? Rest. Look, is rest hard? No. Don't be deceived by these modern versions. You might be tempted one day, you know, this church uses the New King James, but so what? It's a big deal. The pre-tribulation rapture doctrine is pretty new. There's no evidence of anyone teaching it before 1830.
We've got to understand that the 1830s is pretty late in history. I mean, for thousands of years from the time of Christ, we went through the Reformation, we went through all sorts of theologians, you know, whatever you do or don't agree with, men like Martin Luther or John Calvin or whatever it is, the fact is that thousands of books, thousands of papers, thousands of essays, and a whole lot of preaching had been done before 1830.
And I'm talking, there's no evidence of anyone from any denomination, any type of Christianity that taught this doctrine. The devil has used this tool of the Scofield reference system of the Bible more than anything to promote this doctrine of the pre-trib rapture. You want to know where it comes from? This is how it got into churches. This is where pastors are getting it. This is where it's coming. It ain't coming from the Bible. It sure didn't come from the mouth of Jesus Christ, but it came from the mouth of Scofield. And so Scofield's notes point to a pre-tribulation rapture, and they lead the reader to believe that it's in Scripture when it's really not there at all. And so because of the Scofield Bible being sent out to so many seminaries and colleges and so many young preacher boys reading the Scofield Reference Bible, they started to just take the pre-tribulation rapture as fact and started preaching it.
Fictionalizations about the imminent rapture also reached the 70s generation through the films of Don Thompson.
Suddenly and without warning, literally thousands, perhaps millions of people just disappeared. A few eyewitness accounts of these disappearances have not been clear, but one thing is certainly sure. Millions who were living on this earth last night are not here this morning.
Thompson's trilogy of thrillers played a significant role in indoctrinating a new generation of teens. Since its premiere, more than 300 million have seen A Thief in the Night. In 1995, Tim Dale House published Tim LaHaye's and Jerry Jenkins' apocalyptic novel, Left Behind.
And this is a fictional series that depicts everybody disappearing and nobody knows where they are. Cars are crashing into each other, airplanes are crashing because the pilot's gone. And this dramatic presentation of the pre-tribulation rapture has become a part of the American culture, and people just accept it to be true. And stupid movie.
Now, when we look at this passage, there are a few characteristics we can see about the rapture, and it will help us identify the rapture in other passages. I'd like you to understand what the rapture consists of. If you look at verse number 16 there, it says, "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven." So the first thing that we got to understand about the rapture is that the Lord is coming down from heaven with a shout and with the voice of the archangel, and I want you to make note of this, and with the trump of God. That's the second characteristic I'd like you to see about the rapture. So we're going to have the Lord descend, we're going to have the trump of God, and then the Bible says the dead in Christ shall rise first, then we which are alive and remain shall be, make note of these words, caught up together with him in the clouds. The reason I showed you this, because I want you to understand, in Matthew 24, verse 30 and verse 31, we see the rapture, and when we compare it to 1 Thessalonians 4, 15 and 17, it matches up perfectly.
A lot of people will attack this chapter and say this, you can't get your doctrine on this from Matthew 24, because Matthew 24 is only talking to the Jews.
They'll just write this passage off and say, oh, this is only for the Jews.
And some scholar somewhere decided that the book of Matthew is to the Jews, the book of Mark is to the Romans, the book of Luke is to the Greeks, and the book of John is to the world. Oh, thank you, God, for including us in at least one of the four Gospels. But who comes up with this stuff? Now look, maybe Matthew is geared toward the Jews. Maybe Luke is geared toward the Greeks. Maybe the epistle of Paul to the Ephesians was geared toward the Ephesians. Do you think? Maybe the epistle of Paul to the Hebrews was geared toward the Hebrews. Maybe the epistle of Paul to the Thessalonians was geared toward the Thessalonians, but every promise in the book is mine, every chapter, every verse, every line. The book of Titus wasn't just for Titus. That was a short-lived book. It's for every pastor to read. It's for every believer to read. It's the New Testament. Okay, look at the last verse of Mark 13. Mark 13, 37. And what I say unto you, I'm only saying to the Jews. Don't let any preacher try to tell you this is for all believers. It's only for the Jews. Is that what it says in Mark 13, 37? No, it says, and what I say unto you, I say unto all. Watch. That's the last word of the chapter. What I say unto you, I say unto all, watch. And yet people will still turn around and say, this chapter is not talking to all. It's only talking to the Jews. It's almost like he knew that people would say that. And so he just says it at the end. I'm not just talking to you, I'm talking to all when I say watch. This is for everybody. And so to say that this chapter is only talking to the Jews is ridiculous when he flat out says, what I say unto you, I say unto all, watch.
Oftentimes people will look at Matthew 24, verses 30 and 31, and they'll say, well, even though it looks like the rapture, and even though it sounds like the rapture, it's not the rapture, and here's the reason they'll say it's not the rapture. If you look at verse 31, it says, and he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect. And people will look at that word, and they'll say, well, see there, the word elect is not Christians. They'll say the elect is Israel. So therefore, Matthew 24 is not the rapture, is not meant for Christians. This whole chapter is meant for the Jews because he's talking about the elect. But the issue with that is this. We must always allow the Bible to be its own dictionary.
I've got a list here of every time the word elect's used. We're not going to go through it because we don't have time. But I could go through every time elect's used, and I could show you that every single time it's talking about people that are saved.
The reason people believe that the word elect is talking about Jews or talking about Israel is because instead of studying the Bible and instead of reading the Bible, they've been reading commentaries and they've been reading books written by men, and those men have told them what the definition of words are.
The Schofield Reference Bible has a note in Matthew 24 where it says that the word elect is referring to Israel.
But the Bible defines itself, and the Bible gives us the answer to all the questions of doctrines we have. And the word elect, if you study it out in the Bible, simply is not the Jew.
Out of 16 mentions of the term elect in the Bible, I found 10 refer to all believers in general. Two of them refer to believers who are specifically Gentiles. One of them refers to believers who are Jews. Two of them refer to Jesus Christ himself, and one refers to Jacob the person as being God's elect. I'll give you one verse that just clearly shows you that the elect does not mean Israel. Because people say, the elect, that's Israel, that's the Jews. Okay, Romans 11, 7, it says, what then? Israel hath not obtained that which he seeketh for, but the election hath obtained it, and the rest were blinded. So the Bible says, Israel has not, the election has. Well, if Israel were the election, that wouldn't make any sense.
And see, throughout Scripture, it's very clear, if you allow the Bible to define itself, that the elect are not the Jews, that the elect is not the nation of Israel. The elect are believers. They can be from Asia Minor. They can be Greek. They can be barbarians. They can be whatever. Hey, if you've put on Christ, if you're put on the new man, you're considered the elect. So when we go back to Matthew 24, and he says, and he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, they shall gather together his elect, that goes perfectly with the passage in regards to the fact that it is the rapture of believers.
A little later on in the same chapter, he says, but of that day and hour knoweth no man.
So nobody knows the day or the hour when this is going to happen. I can't tell you this is going to happen on October so-and-so of this year. And also later on, he says, then shall two be in the field. The one shall be taken, the other left. Two women shall be grinding at the mill. The one shall be taken and the other left. Watch therefore, for you know not what hour your Lord doth come. So God's telling us we don't know when it's going to be. It's something to watch for. We don't know the day or the hour. But he does tell us that it's after the tribulation. Because he said after the tribulation, the sun and moon are darkened. Then Jesus Christ comes in the clouds. That's when the trumpet sounds. That's when the believers are caught up. So just because we don't know the day or the hour doesn't mean that this is something that could happen at any moment. A lot of people will look at that, no man knoweth the day or the hour, and say, it can happen at any moment. We just finished saying it's after the tribulation. Okay. And this is actually found in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Matthew covers it in Matthew 24. Mark covers it in chapter 13. Luke covers it in chapter 17 and chapter 21. And then John covers it in the book of Revelation. It's covered from all four. First comes the tribulation, then the sun and moon are darkened, then Jesus comes in the clouds for the rapture. Okay. The reason why people think that the rapture is before the tribulation is because they confuse the tribulation with God's wrath. Now, one thing to prove that God's wrath and the tribulation are two completely different things is that in Matthew 24, 29, it says, immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon shall not give her light. So the Bible's real clear in Matthew 24 that the sun and moon are darkened after the tribulation. Well, then if you go to Revelation 6, where you read about when the sun and moon are darkened, when the sixth seal is opened, it says, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood, exactly what it said in Matthew 24. And the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every free man, hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? So, according to this, when does God's wrath begin to be poured out? When the sun and moon are darkened is when they say the great day of his wrath is come. Present tense is come, meaning that it just came. So, if Matthew 24 says that the sun and moon are darkened after the tribulation, and if God's wrath doesn't start until after the sun and moon are darkened, how can they be the same thing? So the wrath doesn't begin until after the sun and moon are darkened. And usually when you try to ask people to show you scripture on the pre-tribulation rapture, they can't show you any verse. And I'll challenge anybody to show me one verse that actually uses the word tribulation in it to support their pre-tribulation rapture position. They can't do it. They have to show you verses that use the word wrath. They'll find verses showing that we as Christians are not under God's wrath. And they'll show verses that say that we're not appointed to wrath and that we are saved from wrath. And they'll say, see right there, the Bible says we're not going to go through the tribulation. But wait a minute, tribulation and wrath are two different things. And so there is no verse that any pre-trib believer can show you that uses the word tribulation in it to prove their doctrine. They'll take you to some verse about God's wrath. Well, God's wrath and the tribulation are two totally different things. And so if we could just get people to understand what the word tribulation means, they would understand that the rapture comes after the tribulation. It's just that people don't understand the word tribulation because they've got this idea in their head that the tribulation is a seven-year period where God's pouring out his wrath and pouring out fire and brimstone, turning water into blood, and tormenting people with scorpions and all these different plagues. That is not what the tribulation is. That's not what the Bible teaches. If you look up every single verse that uses the word tribulation, it's used 22 times in the New Testament. So if the New Testament uses the term tribulation 22 times, and everybody's going around with this doctrine called the pre-trib rapture, shouldn't one of those 22 verses or 22 passages or chapters teach us something about a rapture happening before the tribulation? None of those times says anything about there being a rapture before the tribulation or anything like that. So the pre-tribulation rapture people have to rely on a lot of interpretation. They got to explain it to you. It's always really complicated. And I've noticed something about the Bible. God wants us to understand the Bible,
He's not trying to play tricks on us and confuse us and make things difficult. He wants us to know the truth. He loves us. He says, these things have I spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Did he say you're going to avoid the tribulation? Did he say you're not going to go through tribulation? What did the first mention of tribulation say in Matthew 13? That if people weren't rooted and grounded, and persecution or tribulation would arise because of the word, they would be what? Offended. Look what Jesus said in this chapter that warns us of tribulation in verse 1. These things have I spoken unto you, that ye should not be what? Offended. He says, if I don't tell you about this, if I don't warn you about the coming persecutions and tribulations and trials that you're going to go through in your life, when they come, you're going to be taken by surprise. You're going to be offended. You say, why are you preaching this sermon, Pastor Anderson? I'm preaching this sermon that you might not be offended. You say, wait a minute, this sermon offends. No, this is the sermon to stop you from being offended. Because Jesus said, if you know this is coming, you won't be offended. Look at verse 4. But these things have I told you, that when the time shall come, ye may remember that I told you of them. And these things I said not unto you at the beginning, because I was with you. So he says there, when these things happen, you'll remember, I told you so.
The next time you find the word tribulation is in Acts 14:22, and it says, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith, and that we must through much tribulation enter into the kingdom of God. It's interesting, the statement that is made. It says that we must through much tribulation enter into the kingdom of God. A very specific statement in the Bible that when we enter into the kingdom of God, it'll be through tribulation, not that we're going to enter the kingdom of God before tribulation.
Did he say, man alive, it's great that we're going to be gone before the tribulation? No, he said, you better confirm them. You better firm them up on some things. You better strengthen them, because they better know that they must through much tribulation enter into the kingdom of God. Any pre-tribulation rapture in mention number 6? I didn't think so. And keep in mind, folks, God's not out to confuse us. He's not trying to mess with us. Man has been messing with you. Preachers have been messing with you. TV shows and movies have been messing with you, with Left Behind and all this stuff. God's not messing with you.
If we allow the Bible to be our dictionary and we allow the Bible to define words for us, we would find that the word tribulation is not the wrath of God. It is persecution. It is affliction. It is trouble.
You'd think that somebody could show you one verse of those 22, out of the 22 mentions of tribulation, show me one verse that says we're going to be gone before the tribulation, or we're going to be caught up before the tribulation, or the rapture is going to take place before the tribulation. Yet I can show you where the Bible point blank says, immediately after the tribulation, Jesus is coming in the clouds, the trumpet's going to sound, and the elect will be caught up together with him in the clouds. It's that simple. And so those who believe in the pre-trib rapture, they just have to rely on people with their elaborate interpretations and logic and, well, since we don't know the day or the hour, I guess that means it can happen at any time. And if it can happen at any time, it must be before the tribulation. Or they'll have some kind of a complicated chart that they can use to explain it to you. But if you just pick up the Bible and take it at face value, read the New Testament, start in Matthew chapter 1. When you get to chapter 24, there it is, clear as day. After the tribulation, Jesus comes in the clouds.
The book of Matthew chapter 24, Jesus' sermon, which gives, you know, the disciples ask you very clearly, what's going to happen? What's the sign of your coming? And when is it going to happen? They ask you, you know, the same story is told again in Mark chapter 13 and Luke chapter 21. So I copied pages from the Bible of all three of those passages and put them side by side to make parallel counts, and went through and picked out all the details. And it just became more and more clear that the pre-trib rapture idea just was not true.
Why do you think so many people believe in the pre-trib rapture? Why is this doctrine so popular?
Well, because it answers an embarrassing problem. The Christians couldn't answer the questions about the dinosaurs. Where do they fit? So they made up the gap theory and fell for it. I think the idea that this pre-trib rapture fits into that type of category where people are looking, have itching ears. This is what they want to hear.
Right. Okay.
They want to hear, hey, I won't have to endure suffering. Well, Jesus said there's coming a time of tribulation such as was not since the world began. I mean, do you think the Spanish Inquisition was bad, or the Nazi Holocaust with the Jews was bad, or the Roman persecution of the Christians? it's going to be worse than all of those put together.
Wow, that's amazing.
So the world starts off with Cain killing Abel, the bad guys killing the good guys.
Right.
It's been that way all through history. And Jesus told us, you know, when they kill you or when they persecute you, rejoice because your rewards are great in the kingdom of heaven.
Well, and if we really take a biblical definition of what tribulation means, you know, not what it's been corrupted into meaning, if we actually take the biblical definition of the tribulation, wouldn't you say that you're going through tribulation right now?
Oh, yes. Tribulation is what the world does to us. That right. has already happened for thousands of years. And Jesus said, in the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. So Christians should expect tribulation, and we get great rewards if we go through it patiently.
At least other false doctrines are based on some kind of a Bible verse that they're twisting, and people will take a Bible verse, take it out of context, twist it. The pre-tribulation rapture is not even twisting any scripture. They don't even have a scripture. There is no scripture that says anything about the rapture taking place before the tribulation. It's just a doctrine that's not based on scripture whatsoever. It's based on tradition. It's based on a book or a chart that somebody read. It's not based on the Bible. It didn't come from the Bible. It doesn't have its origins in the Bible. I find that whenever I explain this to people who are in the pew, they have no problem understanding this doctrine. It's the people in the pulpit who will not face this doctrine, and I'll tell you why. The pre-trib rapture is the popular doctrine. If you want to be popular, you're going to preach the pre-trib rapture. You start preaching that the rapture comes after the tribulation, and you're going to be ostracized, you're going to be blackballed, you're going to be rejected from fellowship because they do not want to change on this doctrine. Because there are people out there who have an agenda of making sure that nobody hears the truth on this doctrine. It's true. And the way that they keep this doctrine in the dark is through fear and intimidation. Because I talk to pastors all the time. I show them the truth on this. They agree with me. But they will not go into their pulpit and preach on this doctrine because they are afraid of all their pastor friends turning on them. They're not going to have the speaking engagements. They're not going to be able to preach in these churches because you've got to be pre-trib to be in the club. And if you're not pre-trib, you're not in the club. Many times they won't accept it because they don't want to eat crow because they've been preaching it wrong all these years. They don't want to admit that. They don't want to admit that their Bible college taught them wrong. They don't want to admit that they made a mistake. Now, everybody makes mistakes. We all grow. We all learn new things. And, you know, if you're wrong on something, you got to be corrected on it. So the Bible says in Galatians 1:10, "For do I now persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet pleased men, I should not be the servant of Christ." And these preachers need to decide whether pleasing men is more important by preaching what's popular, preaching the pre-trib rapture, because that's what everybody wants to hear, because they like the movie and they have the video game and the board game and the DVD, or go with what the Bible actually says and get up and preach that the rapture comes after the tribulation. It's a perfect example of people taking what man says over what God says. It's just a classic example of not making the Bible your final authority and just going with tradition, going with what you've been taught, going with what people are saying, going with the flow, instead of going with what the Bible says.